I think you should watch this show. We'll tell you all you need to know. The house this year is split in two. Jason's gang and Marco's crew. Who will win and who will lose? It's up to you, you get to choose. Welcome to Big Brothers Little Brother Friends. Hope you're very well. On the show today, ex-military leadership and teamwork expert Ken Hames helps identify the two tribes that have gone to war in the Big Brother house. Poet Giles Andre pops in to analyse the housemates' attempts at creative writing. Plus, you get the chance to choose what irritating noise Big Brother will wake the housemates up with tomorrow. My voice not included. But first, we kick off with Little Brother's big news. Okie dokes, not usually known for his modesty, Jason was out of their bedroom quicker than an express train last night when he was pounced on by girls who wanted to see what he was hiding under his kilt.
I was like, fuck you, Ray, you're paying us, man! It's the whale dwelling, man!
Because he didn't enjoy that at all. Poor old Victor. First, the girls in the house aren't showing any interest, and now it seems as though his subconscious doesn't want to know either.
Slept very well.
Cool.
I haven't remembered my dream for the first time. I was in the middle of a stand-up fight with an elephant man, and I was losing. I was like, what the hell's going on here? Like, this is supposed to be my dream. How can you be losing in your own dream? Don't make no sense. Like, he was like mega strong, the elephant man. Then I got woken up.
And finally, at 2:46 p.m. this afternoon, the housemates were given a task to draw a still life with Michelle, surprise, surprise, as their muse.
You must choose one housemate as your subject, and the remaining housemates have half an hour to capture their image in a life drawing. After half an hour, Big Brother will ask the subject to judge the pictures and choose one winner. That's hard.
Corbin, that's one.
Yeah, that's the one.
I've chosen this drawing, which was drawn by Shell. There was a short list of three that I chose from, but I've decided that this one is the best. I quite like it, actually. It's very pretty.
Nice. And that was Little Brother's big news for today. So, he started with Daniel and a jar of chocolate spread. He's flirted with Nadia and is all over Vanessa like a rat. Yesterday, he was traced around the Big Brother house by a group of women in negligees. With that in mind, today's Cool BBLB should be not as Jason got the hots, but rather that it is, of all the housemates, is Jason playing the best game? Here's how to get in touch. You can call BBLB on 09011 225 2252. That's 09011 225 2252. Or you can text us your comments. Just put studio, then a space, then your message, and then send it to 83188. Or you can email us at bblb@channel4.com. OK, right now it's your turn to play Evil Big Brother, which is quite fun. We're giving you the chance to choose which annoying noise Big Brother will wake the housemates up with tomorrow morning. And you get the choice of one of the following. I'll play the part of the housemate and I'll wake up and see if it inspires you. OK, I'll be, let's say for the sake of argument, Dan. Option A is dog barking, so I'll just go to sleep and then you wake me up with a dog barking. Ready? That's a dog snarling, to be fair. Not much barking going on there. Annoying B is the sound, annoying option B is the sound of a modem. Let's listen to that. Oh, hang on a second. Oh, someone started a modem, I better get up. And option C is a foghorn. He gods, we're in the port. So, dog barking, modem connecting and a foghorn. What's the alarm to be tomorrow? It's up to you and here's how you text your vote. Which wake-up call should Big Brother use tomorrow? For dogs barking, text poll A to 83188. For a modem, text poll B to 83188. or for a foghorn, text Paul C to 83188. Hi. There's war being waged in the Big Brother house, but which army has the upper hand? Here to help us work that one out is ex-military teamwork and leadership expert Ken Hames, everybody.
Thank you. I'd like to see you, Ken.
How are you?
OK, first of all, what sort of in this sort of cutthroat environment, it's very, very important to be part of a group, right?
Absolutely. I mean, you've got to get in the group. Of course, if you're in the group, you feel a bit more secure, you can hide and hopefully not get voted off.
Yeah, less likely to be nominated. Interesting. Yeah. OK, well, there's two big groups. I don't know if you're a big Big Brother fan. We've got you in here for your expert analysis. Let's take a look at Marco's harem and Jason's jungle cats.
So do you guys think this is a house divided?
It has split, and it maybe two packs.
The two different sides of the house. Massive divide.
I'll break up that little harem, no problem. Me and my fellow jungle cats.
Do you think they're slagging one off?
Can you please ensure that all housemates possibly have more than one brain cell?
The children in the house have just absolutely messed up the whole entire place.
Look at yourselves!
And if Marco screams at everybody, then I'll put him over my knee, man.
She's a Vaseline.
I'll get her in the lines soon, don't you? Whatever working her, man.
In the what?
The lines.
Yeah.
The jungle cat shall rule.
Right, let's take a look at the groups here, Ken. Mm. This is Marco's harem. There's Emma, she's from Lancashire. It's Michelle, Nadia and Marco. Over with Jason's jungle cats. It's a larger group, but it's not as close-knit, I imagine. We've got Dan there, Victor. I'm going to put in the background there. I don't know if you can just see him, because he's not properly part of the group, but he hangs around with them more than he hangs around anyone else. Vanessa Shell, and, of course, the big man himself. In the middle, we've got Stuart, who likes to be part of both groups, considers himself an intellectual heavyweight.
Swinging both ways.
He's having a bit of a hanky-panky with her, right, Michelle? So, let's look at the harem first. Let's take a look.
Lip gloss.
A lot of group bonding. I imagine you used to that sort of thing in the military.
Yeah, particularly those camouflage shorts.
Absolutely. What's your take on it? How important is the group bonding?
Well, I think it's important they get the right uniform on. They seem to have gathered that and
Indeed, got the right shorts, right lipstick. We have some of that. Let's take a look. I believe we can bring our military expert light pen into this. As you can see here, here indeed is the uniform. Here, here, obscured by two enormous glasses, and here. Marco has long shorts on, but does the uniform help?
Yeah, tighter the better, obviously, but I think, you know, it helps them
Ken! You're not looking for the lower the tone.
Yeah. It just helps them to have identity at the end of the day, and that's what they want to beat the rest.
Absolutely. Yeah. Second thing I'm noticing here, Ken, talk me through this. They've got their tools of the trade, as it were, their weapons, as you can see. They've got lipstick here, in the case of Nadia, Emma there, and Marco, I think, has got lip gloss. How important is that? These kind of like little signifiers.
Low-flying lipstick. It just gives them that sort of, you know, that air of unity. When people are looking at them from a distance, they can see, oh, these people are all using the same tools.
I need one of them to get into that gang.
Get into that group, yeah.
Could we call that a weapon in many ways?
Yeah, it is a weapon. Yeah.
Okay, brilliant. Now, if they lose Emma and Michelle, pictured here and here, on Friday into the bedsit, I mean, what sort of effect will that have on the group? There'll be only two of them.
I don't know, because I think the leader's still there. I think that's the big thing. Nadia's still there. I think she's going to be in charge, however many.
You see Nadia as that. She does take control, doesn't she, Nadia?
She does.
Okay, what about Marco? How important is Marco to that group? I mean, he calls it Marco's hearing, but is that just him alone?
I think he's the energizer in the group. He's the one who's, you know, getting them moving and motivating them from behind.
Yeah. Okay, cool. Next up, we move on to the jungle cats. Jason seems to be the leader. He has absolutely no problem whatsoever sending his men out into the front line. Take a look at this.
Sit in discussions, and for something that you don't agree with, you say it. Create
conflict. That's what I think you'll be good at.
How many cigarettes did you bring with you?
300.
300 cigarettes. If someone smokes near me, it affects me.
Yes. No,
you're a smoker.
Let's not do this first thing in the morning.
How many cigarettes you bring? 300 cigarettes. I cannot understand. An honest smoker that brings 300 cigarettes.
Okay, Ahmed.
That's it.
What brought you all that up, Ahmed?
Eh?
What brought all that up?
This is very clever from Jason, isn't it?
Yeah, divide and rule. I think it's a classic military tactic, don't you?
He's not like a team player, though, is he, in that respect? Because he's sending his man out over the front there and he's nowhere to be seen.
Yeah, and I think the whole of UK can see that he's playing some dirty tricks here. You know, I don't know how that's going to endear him, really. I think it could be his downfall
in
some ways.
OK, well, let's take a closer look. I want your military expert eye on this. As you can see, up here, we have Ahmed. He's pointing down, gesticulating. He's quite aggressive.
Yep.
He's got the higher ground, which is quite important, I imagine. Down here, Marco. He's almost putting a hand up, saying, no, no. How important is that sort of gesticulation up there?
Well, I think, you know, it's obviously, as you say, he's feeling threatened because he's up and over and above him, you know, obviously giving him a lot of verbal, which is, I don't think he takes that too well.
No, he does it very well as well, Ahmed, doesn't he? Interestingly, though, very Machiavellian. Mm. Where is he? To be seen, the boss man. Mm. Where are you, Jason? Nowhere to be seen. Does Ahmed make a good wingman in your...
Well, I think he could. I mean, if he goes into the bedsit with whoever, then I think he may come out a completely different character. I mean, he's changed since he's known about the nomination. Mm-hmm. You know, he's dropped his sort of, you know, facade and he's, you know, I think he's on a roll at the moment.
He's a wild man. Is he too unpredictable to be a team player, though?
No, I don't think so. I think he's been put up to this, you know, and I think it's going to change.
Lastly, which group do you see ruling the roost?
Well, I personally wouldn't be for that aggressive approach.
Yeah.
You know, I think, you know, the stealth and the fun side of things could win the day. You know, I think that, you know, the joy in that group might be better than the sort of hard line, you know, we're going to go out to get them.
OK, Ken, thank you very much for your input. More from you later on. Still to come, an insight into the mind of this week's nominees as we take a closer look at their poetry skills. Forsooth. Welcome back to our show. There's only 15 minutes to go. You may have noticed I'm speaking in rhyme. That's because it's Poetry Corner time. Cue the classical music. Oh, the bougies. Joining me today in Poetry Corner is Giles Andre, writer of the Purple Ronnie poems, everybody. Nice to see you. Giles, in your opinion, what makes a good poem? What is it structurally?
Well, I think what it has to do, a good poem has to make an emotional connection with the reader first and foremost. And I think I would look for something that perhaps sheds some light on the human condition, that helped us to understand our own lives. And perhaps structurally, something lyrically attractive, something beautiful to listen to, really.
Ah, right. Bit of a problem then. We can't actually promise any of that. But before the housemates enter the house, we ask them to pen us a poem, and by the magic of technology, we're now going to hear them recite their masterpiece. This is CGI graphics, the like of which Titanic probably hasn't even seen. We're looking today at our nominees, Michelle, Ahmed, and Emma. We're going to start with Emma. Let's let you think about this.
Hello, pet. This is My Fight by Emma Greenwood. Why do we fight, I ask? No violence. Just the pain of what the mind can do. I ask myself when I sit alone, why do you do the things you do? Imagine the red fire around you. You're trapped. But if you don't know if that's true. I lay my cards on the table, tended to accept the things I do. One day in time, I'll change my mind. I want to know what silence knows. So one can understand to be free. Soon, that will be me. Oh.
You're not clapping very hard. What did you find out about that poem?
Well, I'm so moved, to be honest. I want to know what silence knows. That says it all for me.
I like that line.
Yeah, it's a troubled poem, though. It's a dark poem. We're clearly looking right into Emma's soul.
Is it quite depressed?
There. Well, it seems like it comes from quite a depressed spirit, yes, certainly.
Would you like to read more of her work, or do you think...
Oh, I'd be delighted. I'd like to publish it if I could.
Giles, don't be playing around with me now. OK, next up is Michelle's poem. I don't think it'd probably be as dark. Let's take a look.
When I go into the Big Brother house, I'm sure it'll be a blast. But some will surely dig some dirt with the people from me past. The house of sex is what they want. I'm sure they're very keen to see me boobs and see my bum and everything in between. Ooh. So when I wake on the first day, you know it won't be long before I'm in that jacuzzi wearing nothing but a thong. Right, chicken? That one's for you, Stu. What do we make of that?
Well, emotionally, perhaps not quite as heavyweight, but I think it's fair to say that technically it's extremely accomplished. I mean, it rhymes and it scans very regularly. I like it very much, to be honest. I think it's a good piece.
Lastly, this is what Ahmed wrote. Now, he's not big into poetry, but he did have this to say. I hate poems. I like action and doing things. Like flirting. La, 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 la. Well, there's Ahmed. Yeah. Before anyone thinks we are, of course, setting him up, I do have his poem here. I don't like poems. I prefer, that's exactly what he said to us. I prefer action, doing things, and flirting. But this, in its own way, is a poem, is that right?
Well, you could say so. I mean, you could say that's a very minimalist piece of free verse. I suspect it's not, but you could say that, yes. I think it's a bit of a shame that he didn't.
Out of the three, then, which do you find inspires you the most? The first one there, Emma's?
Which inspires me the most? Well, I think.
Michelle's, perhaps, the one about raw sexuality.
I think that certainly throbbed for me. I think technically, to be honest, I prefer that poem, but emotionally, I prefer Emma's.
Excellent. OK, thank you. Well, fortunately for our viewers, one of our viewers came to the rescue. We have Trudy Harrison on the line now, who's written her own poem, who's written her own poem about Ahmed. Hello there, Trudy.
Hello there, young man.
How are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
Excellent. Trudy, be my guest to take it away.
OK. You stand alone. Lost, like a child seeking approval, but not knowing how it comes. Your story you keep under lock and key, whilst you try to relate to the ones born free. So self-indulged, these fickle creatures of youth, obsessed by sex, but not by truth. Your journey has been hard, but they cannot see. Ahmed, long may you continue to be. I pray you find someone to hug you, a place where your soul runs free, and the blessings of being salute you, and you smile once more, naturally.
Well, that's lovely. Trudy, thank you so much. Charles, what did you make of Trudy's?
Well, it's a poem of great beauty and insight and spirituality. I think it captures Ahmed's character extremely well. I think it's just a bit of a shame he didn't write it himself.
Yes, indeed. Thanks to all our guests today. We hope we've helped in some small way. The Big Brother bedsit is waiting for two. But who should it be? It's up to you. To vote for Ahmed, dial 09011 214401 or text Ahmed to 84444. To vote for Emma, dial 09011 214403 or text Emma 84444. To vote for Michelle, dial 09011 214407 or text Michelle 84444. OK, still to come, we're finding out what you think Jason is up to on Cool BBLB. But first, a quick recap of today's news. Last night, Jason was given a helping hand undressing and the girl's trying to find out where he keeps under his kilt. Victor had a very odd dream about fighting the Elephant Man. And finally, Michelle Arbel poses for a still live session. Half an hour to capture that. OK, you've been voting for which wake-up alarm you want played into the Big Brother house tomorrow with a whopping 82%, I believe it is. The winner is the Foghorn. To be fair, it's not easy for people to just clap a foghorn, so they probably weren't prepared for that. Today's Cool BBLB is, of all the housemates, is Jason playing the best game? The boys are still with us. Let's go to the lines. Hello there, Alex from Devon.
Hi there.
Hello, Alex. How are you?
Fine, thank you.
Had me a little bit worried there for just a second. What do you think? Is Jason playing the best game, or is he just being himself, or what?
I think he is playing a good game, but for me, he's playing the girls against the boys.
Playing the girls against the boys?
Yeah.
So it isn't this whole group we looked at today?
For me, he's he's using his body to win the girls over.
Right.
More than the boys. I can see that Dan's got a crush on him,
mm-hmm.
like most people can. But for me, he is actually playing the girls against the boys to bring his popularity up.
Do you think the boys might vote him out then for, you know, being, you know, turning the, or getting the girl vote?
I think the boys might vote him out, yeah.
Really?
Okay. Yeah.
It's all about hearts and minds, isn't it?
Yeah, well, he's playing a dangerous game, isn't he, Alex?
He's a bit.
Yeah, he's playing a dangerous game. Everybody can see that he's being divisive right from the start. He might think that's a winning formula, but, you know, will he, you know, will he last the race?
I don't think he will.
You don't think he will?
No.
Alex, thank you very much. Appreciate it. Cool.
Cheers.
Euphenia?
Hello?
Hello.
You alright?
How do I pronounce your name?
Euphemia.
Oh, it wasn't too far
off. Get it right, David.
I know. And surprise, surprise, you're from London.
Yeah, I could have come from London.
Hello, how are you?
I'm alright.
Excellent. What do you think?
Well, I think that Jason really needs to, like, you know, watch out for his tan lines and trying to get all these girls in line.
Yeah.
His game plan is really weak and he needs to get away from Victor. Because he will flop just like Victor's flopping at the moment.
He's not representing
London at all, no.
Would you not say he's more of a dominant male than Victor is?
Well, anyone's a better male than Victor, that's my opinion at the moment anyway. I think he's just making us black people look stupid at the moment, to tell the truth.
Yeah, are you seriously annoyed about that?
Yeah.
Mm. I think you'd be more annoyed if you were a man, wouldn't you?
What do you mean?
You'd be more annoyed if you were a man. I mean, you know, as a man, Victor is not painting us in a very good light sometimes. All that's going on about these women and so forth.
Yeah, I know. But I don't class him as a man, do you know what I mean, Jim? At the end of the day, he is just, you know, I swear, if you got him in the house for one day, I'd put him in his place.
What'd you do to him?
I'd put him in his place.
What'd you do?
I'd distress him. I'd make him feel so stupid. He's all telling Nadia about her chin. He needs to watch out for his hairline. Do you know what I mean? Why did he just keep the hat on all day?
He's on the case.
He needs to watch out for that hairline. Do you know what I mean? And then man breast that he's got going on. What's going on with the man breast? And his big t-shirt that he wears all day. One leg up, one leg down. What's going on? He's not representing London at all.
I wish we had answers for you, Phenia. I can quite honestly say I don't believe we've ever had a caller like you. And I thank you from the bottom of my heart for it.
All right, love.
Thanks for your passion. Take care.
Anytime.
Woo! Get her down. Let's go to some emails. Brett Archibald, Jason doesn't have a game plan. He's just a bit frustrated. He wants to get off with someone, even if it's Nadia. I actually agree with that. I think he's genuinely quite... you know, keen. Justin from Shepherd's Bush, probably our last call today. Hello, Justin.
Hello, Dermot.
Go for it.
Well, I don't think he's got that much of a game plan at all. I think he's massively insecure.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see all that in the grooming and the bodybuilding and the exhibitionism. Okay. But really, the Navy would have been a great training for him because, you know, you're cooped up, crowded, uncomfortable, confined, constrained, all of that stuff. Very disciplined rules, having to achieve all these ridiculous little task.
You're loving a bit of that, aren't you?
Yeah.
Justin, thank you very much. OK, that's all we've got time for tonight. Thanks to the guys. Really appreciate your time. Big Brother tonight. Enjoy us tomorrow.